Alrighty, hey friends, welcome to, whoops, another Nerdventures video. This one releasing pretty soon after the others just because it needs to be timely because these are the July previews. So, I'm trying something with a new microphone and we'll see if it works, syncing up the audio. If not, it's going to sound like it usually does, but if it does sound better, hopefully it's a result of that. So, we'll see how it goes. Before we get started, I wanted to mention that apart from these previews things, there are other ways, perhaps sneakier ways, I don't know, depending on how you view it, to figure out what is going to be released in the upcoming months. One thing that I've been following along with recently, and that if you are somebody who's going to sit down and watch 30 minutes of me flipping through this book, you'll probably be interested in this, is that you can actually find a lot of leaks on Amazon. I'm sure a lot of people know about this, but if you basically go to, like, if you search, for example, if you go to the comic book section or the book section, whatever it is, and you search for hardcovers, then there's a drop-down list on the right side, and you can switch the sorting to publication date. And when you switch it to publication date, it puts you at the things that are coming out the furthest away. And because of this, in the recent, you know, just like the last 2 or 3 weeks, there's been quite a few Omni and hardcover collections leaked. So, just, you know, to put it on your radar, if you are somebody who collects hardcovers, then probably it would be fortuitous for you to know, you know, what's coming out so you don't spend your money on things when they're going to be collected in different ways soon. Anyway, so, for example, this recent one, there was a Daredevil Silver Age omnibus leaked, which is really cool. The original, like, Daredevil stuff from way back in the day in the 60s. There was a Mark Waid Daredevil omnibus, so the hardcovers are getting collected in that. There's a Batman Nightfall omnibus, which had only been collected in trades previously. I think I'm missing a few other things. There was a couple of them. What was the other one? Oh, Guardians of the Galaxy Classic by Jim Valentino, which was the previous classic team. So, basically, my point is that if you enjoy these, you know, maybe take some time to search around Amazon, see if you can find any leaks and stuff, because there's lots of different ways to figure out what's coming out soon. So, I'm going to set these aside for now, and we're going to dive right in, as per usual, to our previews catalog, which has the Marvel Now relaunch bit on the back and on the front. This is about the Young Animal imprint, which is kind of interesting. Basically, like, sort of like a Vertigo thing, like a side imprint from DC, which is being curated or written, whatever, run by Gerard Way and Nick Darrington. And there's a couple different things that they're talking about in here. So it looks cool. I'm glad to see DC sort of switching it up a little bit. This is the July 2016 previews for items shipping in September, although, of course, as always, there will be early solicits in here. That's the case with most hardcovers, so let's dive right in. And let's start with Dark Horse. Here's some stuff just wanted to mention, just because I always like to stop at Conan. If you're into these Conan books, the 33rd volume of the Marvel Conan stuff is out. It says also available down here, volumes 10 through 31. I don't know if that means 1 through 9 are out of print. That's possible. But this just keeps on trucking. This collects 259 through 267, so many, many years after you know, the original stuff started in the 70s. But one day I would like to own all of those. So volume 33 of Conan, as well as the complete ElfQuest trade paperback volume 3. These are like black and white, like sort of phone book size, I guess you would say, books from Dark Horse. There have been two previous ones, 1 and 2, which collect the older stuff. And then I believe this is the sort of the 90s stuff, the Dreamtime and the Hidden Years. So stuff when I don't actually know how much Richard and Wendy Pinney were working on it at that point, but a bunch of different artists and people were working on ElfQuest in the 90s. So if you are interested in ElfQuest, there's more ways to collect it. This looks interesting to me. I don't know anything about it. This is Alistair and Adolf hardcover, which seems to be talking about Aleister Crowley and Adolf Hitler. I really don't know anything about Douglas Rushkoff. I know Michael A. von Oeming. I believe he was the artist of Powers with Bendis. Pretty sure. So, yeah, down there, Powers. And a foreword by Grant Morrison, which makes me think it's going to be a pretty mind-twisty kind of thing. So, it's kind of cool. Like, it looks like just a standalone hardcover graphic novel about some type of powerful and dangerous occult weapon that Crowley develops for the Axis powers. And if you're into, like, brings to my mind, like, Wolfenstein and stuff like that, those kind of, like, alternative history World War II stuff that's, like, more based in occult craziness, then maybe that'd be a cool thing to check out. I really don't know, but just keep it on the radar, Aleister and Adolf. Here we have the massive Library Edition Volume 2, which is another 15 issues of the massive in a massive, haha, sick puns, oversized hardcover, Library Editions from Dark Horse. Always happy to see more Library Editions. I am interested in the massive. I have the first one, and I believe that there's actually like a there's some type of massive miniseries that's coming out in Library Edition before this one, I think. If I remember correctly, like last month or the month before, there was something called like the Ninth Wave or something like that. So if you're into Brian Wood and the massive, the Library Editions keep on rolling. This one is an early solicit for November. $40 for that oversized content. You know, you can't really beat Dark Horse on their price on those, so pretty cool. And I do not know how many issues the massive had overall, but I am happy to keep buying it because the first book, Library Edition that is, was quite nice, looks great on the shelf, and I'd love to continue on that series. This is interesting to me. I really don't know anything about it, except that it's a heavy metal piece. This is called Ranks by Stefano Tamburini and Tinino Liberatore. Sorry if I butchered that. But this is basically a hardcover volume, an oversized volume, or maybe regular size, I'm not sure. It's not Library Edition, but it's definitely like a nice size. It's not like really tiny. And it basically collects all of these Ranks stories that were done through the 80s in heavy metal. If you don't know about heavy metal, it was like an adult science fiction fantasy comic book magazine that was an adaptation of a French magazine before that, and then a lot of those French stories were published in heavy metal, as well as some original stuff. So this is like basically one of those things that ran through a number of issues in heavy metal. Dark Horse is putting it out here in a hardcover for the first time altogether. So if you're into, like, heavy metal has a very, like it says here, ultra-violence and hyper-sexual kind of vibe to it. So if you're into, like, that kind of adult 80s magazine stuff, then that's a really cool pickup. I'm probably going to get this, even though I don't really know much about it, just based on kind of the pedigree of the heavy metal and that time period. And then right next to it is the fourth volume of the Kabuki Library Edition set that Dark Horse is going through. I think I've mentioned this before, I have the first one, didn't really care for it, so I haven't picked it up since then, but if you like David Mack's stuff, which this cover is pretty indicative of his style, kind of a collage-y, like, fine art illustration, is how I would describe it, not really knowing how to describe it. I don't know, it's less illustration, like, comic book art, and more kind of, like I said, abstract and kind of leaning towards a fine art thing, which I don't exactly love, but if you are into, Dark Horse is making all of that available in Library Editions and continuing that onward, so pretty good collection on that page, actually. Yeah, and it looks like that's about it for Dark Horse. I'm pretty happy with some of that stuff. You know, getting some more archive stuff from the heavy metal is cool, and then those Library Editions that are out there are pretty neat as well. So not a huge offering, but some quality stuff in there. And on to the DC stuff. Basically, on this one, there's a big announcement of the Trinity comic book coming back, written and illustrated by Francis Manapul. I'm pretty jazzed about that. I mean, I'm not going to be picking it up when it first comes out, but I really like Manapul's art. If you can see it right here, it kind of has like I don't really know how to describe it, but it looks like a lighter kind of version. It doesn't have the kind of heaviness and like the grunginess that some of the DC house style or like DC artists do. So I'm glad to see more stuff from Manipul, and getting this full series will be nice eventually all collected. This is the stuff I was talking about, Young Animal. It's basically, let's see, the first and foremost is about the art of making comics, the teams and the collaboration and the desire of creators to do new and experimental things. So as I said, it really sounds like they're trying to harness the nostalgia and the, you know, good vibes that Vertigo from the late 80s through, you know, mid 90s had. So I'll be interested to see what they come up with. Looks like they're launching with a Doom Patrol. I know that they're launching with like Shade, the Changing Man, Doom Patrol, some other stuff that I'm not, I don't remember off the top of my head, but it looks like this one is what they're soliciting right now for September, which is a Doom Patrol reboot, basically. So Young Animal, look for that. Hopefully it will, you know, live up to the its aspirations of being like a nice creator driven DC sub imprint. So hopefully I'm hopeful. I mean, Gerard Way has had good he's the lead singer for My Chemical Romance, if you're not familiar, and he was a comic book author and illustrator before that and can continue to do that, so I trust him to some extent. So you know, I'm willing to follow a Young Animal and see where they go. This is that Trinity that I was talking about, the Francis Manipul book. So very excited to see that eventually. Alrighty, and into the collected editions where my bread and butter lies. This is the DC Rebirth Omnibus, which is pretty cool. It collects all of the Rebirth one-shots that have been going on throughout the DC universe in the last 3 months or so. I think like May through July, about. $75 will be on sale in December. Seems like a good price point. Even though in past videos I've talked about how Rebirth was sort of a turnoff for me in a lot of ways in its intentions, I actually still think that the execution and the actual content itself, I did enjoy what I read. So I will be picking this up, if not just for like historical reasons, just a, you know, interesting thing. Like, because a lot of the times, like the New 52 Omnibus and stuff was a bunch of number ones, and I didn't feel like picking that up because they're number ones that are attached to number twos. Everything in here is a one-shot to, like, reset the universe to a certain way, and then the series moves on from there. So I feel like you can kind of read all of these and just get, like, a snapshot of Rebirth and just, like, understand what they're doing with that line. So I am more excited about the Omnibus than I thought I would be. I am looking forward to getting that, and especially the DC Rebirth issue itself, the ones that Geoff Johns wrote. I liked a lot of the art in that, so I'd like to see it on those nice pages. And then moving on next to it is something that I was, I'm not going to say afraid was going to happen, but I think I pretty much called this when I was bashing on Johns and DC for bringing the Watchmen back into the universe and the bungled, in my opinion, handling of it. I think this points exactly to why they're doing it, because it's the 30th anniversary of Watchmen. Last month they solicited a collector's set of all the books. This month they're soliciting a Watchmen Noir hardcover. It's just, it just seems like, and it seems like largely the stuff that was done in Rebirth in relation to Watchmen was an effort to set up this kind of thing where you can sell the same content five different times to different people. So, I'm not going to be picking this up. I already have the Absolute, and I'm not really into the noir stuff. Like, I know there's been Batman noirs that people have enjoyed, but if you are into Watchmen and would like an oversized black and white version of it, just to, like, see, you know, the art and the pencils and inks by Dave Gibbons, then this might be for you. It's not for me, but it looks like it's going to collect, yeah, the entire series in black and white for the first time if you are somebody who likes comics in black and white, which I am. I actually do enjoy seeing black and white stuff. Just for Watchmen, I'm not particularly, I don't need that like peeling back of the series, just because Dave Gibbons' art is I don't know. It's good enough for me just to see it in color. I don't really need the next special edition of Watchmen. But if you're a Watchmen super freak, or if you are a black and white comics collector, then that might be a cool way to get it. It's just, I sort of want to give a waggle of my finger to DC, because seeing these two next to each other just further illustrates my point that the plot decisions of Rebirth were maybe questionable storytelling-wise and made for more financial reasons. Here's one that's generated a lot of bad feelings in the comic book circles that I run with online, and that is the Absolute Infinite Crisis hardcover. Infinite Crisis is a well-remembered, and I have not read it, but a well-loved series from Geoff Johns, which was one of the kind of like... out of the modern crisis, there's Identity Crisis, which then the events of that, you know, spun into Infinite Crisis, and the events of that spun into Final Crisis, and then the events of that kind of spun into Flashpoint and the New 52. So, seeing this, a lot of people were angry because there was an Infinite Crisis omnibus released a number of years ago, and it's very hard to find now. It's very expensive, like in the $300 range, or at least $200+, and it's not of particularly great construction, but it does collect the series as well as a lot of tie-ins, which people feel are very helpful for understanding the series. I think there were like four tie-in series with like maybe six or seven issues each that led into the Infinite Crisis event, and apparently they're, if not essential, at least very helpful in understanding it. And so now we're getting this Absolute Infinite Crisis, which basically prints the actual event itself in absolute form, you know, the super oversized slipcase, but not the tie-ins or the lead-up stuff. And the reason people are angry about that is because they would rather see a reprint of the omnibus with all of the content that they want than see DC charging, you know, even more for an Absolute Edition, which is missing some of the stuff that some people find essential. I am still going to pick this up. I still am interested in it. I have not read Infinite Crisis, and to me, it doesn't really bother me that much if I have to track down like four trade paperbacks and kind of get a little bit of backstory before I go into it. I don't really care. But I am also a big proponent of the Absolute style anyway. I like that sort of book, that oversized premium collector's mentality. So depending on how you feel about it, your mileage might greatly vary on this one. I could see this one being an Absolute that a lot of people pass up just out of kind of frustration with DC not giving them what they want with an omnibus reprint. But, you know, it's there if you like it. Oversized slipcase, which, like it says, is the whole Infinite Crisis series, along with the initial proposal and art breakdowns for issue one and a couple other bonus things. So sort of just like a deluxe collector's edition for people who are into the Infinite Crisis event. And yeah, controversial, but you know, you can make up your own mind about that, whether or not it's worth the $100 price point, you know, $50 at launch, basically, or launch, $50 upon release. So that is totally up to you whether it's worth it. But for me, it will be worth it just because I am interested in that series, and I love me some Absolutes. And then moving over to this page, I just wanted to mention real quick the Batman by Ed Brubaker trade paperback that's up here. Early solicit for October. And I am a little disappointed because I would like to see these collected in like an omnibus, like a Ed Brubaker Batman Omni. I have not picked up the Volume 1. I actually don't know if Volume 1 is out yet. It might be coming out very soon, if it's not out yet. But yeah, I love Ed Brubaker, and I eventually want to get all or most of the stuff that he's worked on. So this will work its way into my wish list, but it's not an immediate buy for me. But if you're into Ed Brubaker and Batman and the kind of noir stylings that he brings to his writing, it seems very neat, and I would like to get that content eventually. On this page, we have some kind of interesting stuff. Superman, The Golden Age Omnibus Volume 3. To me, it's not particularly interesting, but I'm just really glad to see that DC is sticking with this kind of Golden Age, Silver Age Omni line enough to get three volumes out of a character. So hopefully this will be basically the definitive way to collect these whole big runs of older comics, which, you know, DC had their archive series a while ago, which they kind of did, and then it was like went away, and then it was sort of fiddles out or whatever. But it looks like they're going to be basically collecting most of that content in these omnibus formats. And then over here, you can see what they're also starting to do is put out trade paperbacks collecting the same content as these omnis. So I believe right now there was just a trade paperback release for, I think, Flash Silver Age. Now there's going to be one for Green Lantern Silver Age. So if you're not interested in these, you know, more expensive sort of $75 to $100 price point omnibooks, there are ways to collect this older content, which is always nice. I'm a big proponent of, I don't know if historical preservation is the right word, but I'm a big proponent of being able to look back at series and have them in print and feel like there's not things that you have to like really hunt down and find. Like, I love being able to easily access these Golden and Silver Age things, even if it's not, you know, with Superman, it's not exactly my cup of tea. I'm glad that they're doing this and making it available. I think that's about it for what I found interesting. Maybe there's some stuff in Vertigo. More like Vertigo. Oh, just kidding. Sweet Tooth Deluxe Edition, Volume 3. Just continuing on the Sweet Tooth Deluxes from Jeff Lemire. I think this is... Yeah, this is the last one. There were only 40 issues in the series, so this will be the final kind of 14 issues. Finishing it up, and that'll be nice to sit next to my other Vertigo Deluxes on the shelf. I don't think, you know, Absolute Preacher just came out like 2 or 3 days ago, and Vertigo and DC is kind of in a weird spot with like collecting all their series as hardcovers and then thick trade paperbacks and then absolutes, and I don't know that Sweet Tooth is something that will ever get an absolute. It doesn't seem like a series that will get an absolute, but just having it in these deluxes is enough for me, and I'm glad that they are finishing that out, just because I've wanted to read that series and I have not started it because I don't have it all yet, but I love me some Jeff Lemire, so I will be checking it out and going through that series, giving you guys my review as soon as I have all of that content within my reach. And I think that is basically it for DC. This is a nice Francis Manapul Flash, based on the designs from the New 52 Flash, and yeah. A couple different collector's fig stuff. So I thought that was a pretty good offering from DC. I mean, the variety of stuff is nice, like Omni from recent series, Omni from Golden Age stuff, Omni from, you know, the early 2000s. Like, it's nice to see them curating everything at once and kind of bringing out lines of different omnibus and absolutes that you could get from basically any era of DC that you're interested in. So, DC, I am... happy that you have that variety in your collections department, because it's nice to be able to get that content from all different types of times and people and artists and stuff. All right, so this is about halfway through the IDW solicits, and I wanted to stop on this one because I think this is pretty interesting. This is the Jack Kirby Artisan Edition, Pencils and Inks from IDW. I am happy to see this because they did this with Wally Wood already. There was an Artisan one, and instead of being like the super, super large, kind of 12 by 17 or like even like 15 by 22 or whatever some of those artist editions are, this one is a 8 by 12 offering, so still oversized and still able to see the pages on a nice oversized thing, but instead of being, you know, 100 to 120, it's more like a $50 price point. I think I will be picking this up because I love Jack Kirby so much, and I do want to go back and pick up the Wally Wood one as well, because as much as I would love to get into Artist Edition, just the price and the size of them is not conducive to me buying and collecting them. Honestly, I feel like books of that size, that kind of artist edition size, I buy them and then I don't really read or look at them that much. Like, it's just so large and it kind of like, I don't know, it's hard to explain it. Like, it's nice to sit on the shelf, but I don't pull them down that much and kind of look at them. And in contrast to that, I think something that is soft cover and a little bit, or no, I guess this is a hardcover, something that is easier to you know, get down and look at and kind of just have. I don't know. Maybe I'm just bullshitting myself into trying to rationalize picking this up. I just feel like the size and the price and the content on this to me is more in my wheelhouse than like 125 on just like a big huge, you know, artist edition. This is looks like it's all going to be Jack Kirby's DC stuff from like 1970 to 1975, that kind of era of Kirby's DC work. So cool to pick up. Demon, OMAC, and Commandy are the three examples, and those all look really nice. So if you're interested in artist edition stuff but have always been hesitant to pull the trigger like I have, or found yourself not really looking at them, or really like, I don't know, I just don't get that much value out of them, unfortunately. I wish I did, but I just don't really look at them that much, and this seems like a nice compromise between those, so excited to see that. And then turning the page over, we get the America's Best Comics Artist Edition, which is kind of, I don't know if surprising to me is the right word, I just didn't expect something like this, but it's basically like America's Best Comics was a imprint of, it might still exist, I'm not sure, but it's an imprint of DC that was run basically by Alan Moore, put out things like Promethea, Top 10, and Tom Strong, which you can see on these different things. And yeah, this is basically your standard probably $100, $125 artist edition with different pieces from all of these different America's Best Comic series. So if that was something that you loved, that period of ABC stuff that Alan Moore was working on, then this is going to be right up your alley. But you know, I don't know if it's exactly for me. just wanted to stop and mention this real quick, just because I've been getting really into old comic strip stuff, and this is Rip Kirby Volume 9. I believe that it was worked on by, I think Alex Raymond was the original Rip Kirby guy, but I think he only probably worked on it through like what has been collected in Volumes 1 through 4, and then other artists and creators went on this. So this is the like 19, it looks like 60s era, from 1967 to 1970. So if you're into sort of detective and comic strip stuff, then there you are. Rip Kirby. I'm going back and trying to pick up a lot of those right now, so maybe it would just be interesting to check out if you've never checked it out before, because I find it to be pretty cool. As well as this one, Red Berry Undercover Man. I am very excited about this. This is, I was just about to say, Will Gould, I wonder if he's related to Chester Gould. So no, he's not. No relation to Chester Gould. Chester Gould famously did Dick Tracy, and it says that Red Berry and Secret Agent X-9, which Secret Agent X-9 is really cool. It was done by Dashiell Hammett, I think, back in the day, and then was it Al Williamson took it over eventually? It looks very nice. I'm wanting to pick those up as well, but this looks like a very cool detective strip sort of thing. It's going to be two volumes, which will print the dailies as well as the color Sundays. So this is the first of two volumes of the Red Berry comic strip. Very excited to get this. And yeah, 1930s classic golden age sort of comic strip stuff. Something I'm becoming more and more interested in, and I'm definitely going to cover more on the channel. So check it out if you are interested in that time period. And yeah, IDW is kind of cool. I mean, decent amount of stuff. For me, IDW is basically just either artist editions or the comic strip reprints. Like I've said, they have a lot of cool stuff in their comic strip reprints, and they have a lot of cool stuff in their artist editions, but it just has to hit me the right way to get me to spend money on it, because their stuff is not exactly cheap, you know, relative to what it is. So let's move on to Image Comics. So as per usual, I will give you my Image Comics spiel. I say this every time, so I'm sorry if you're tired of hearing it. But Image Comics is awesome. Image Comics is great. I respect the hell out of everything that they do. I think that their creator-owned stuff is super cool. And there's so many series in here that I would love to read. For me personally, as somebody who doesn't pick up monthly comics and just picks up the collections, you know, there isn't that much. This solicit, what they have is an October solicit for The Fade Out, which I am very excited for. Another Brubaker and Phillips kind of noir sort of styling. And I believe that this is the entire thing. I think it's just going to be these 12 issues. So if you are into Brubaker and Phillips, which I very much am, and I think a lot of people are, Fade Out Deluxe Edition will be an awesome hardcover to add to the Brubaker Phillips collection, which has a lot of stuff through Image and other things as well. But, you know, obviously there's tons and tons of amazing quality series from Image. You know, absolutely go through and check it out on your own and see what appeals to you. But I'm not going to talk about them all here because there's just too many. So for me, the only thing that looks really interesting is this Fade Out Deluxe. But, you know, check out Image's library on your own because there's lots and lots of really cool things. And now it's time to segue into Marvel's previews. Let's see what we have going on from these guys this month. Alright, so as you might expect, lots and lots and lots of series from Marvel. I'm not going to go over them because I don't read most of them, so I don't have much opinion. If you can see up here, like this chunk of it is all related to Civil War crossovers. And then there's some Avengers books. Marvel kind of groups their stuff together now into different, like, chunks of content. So mostly they're focused these days on Civil War II and all these different crossovers and tie-ins. So interested if you're into that. This is interesting to me, not necessarily because of the content, but because of the format. So this is the Wolverine Origin Complete Collection. Previous to this, as far as I know, Complete Collection has always been reserved, unless I'm mistaken. This, it could be that those are called Ultimate Collections, but as far as I know, the Complete Collection has been something that's only been soft cover standard size from Marvel. So it is interesting to me that we're getting an basically like an oversized hardcover of Wolverine Origin. So I'm wondering if that means that the Complete Collection hardcover line is basically going to replace Marvel's OHC line, which they haven't been keeping up with recently. It's been like they've sort of dropped out of oversized hardcovers in favor of doing Omnibus or the Epic Collections. So I don't know if this is going to be like a new middle ground for that, sort of like Epic Collections are going to be, you know, one thing, and then Complete Collection hardcovers and then Omni. I don't know. I'm not really sure. But yeah, if you're interested in Wolverine Origin, there will be a oversized hardcover for it. And then over on this side is a early solicit for the January Deadpool Beginnings Omnibus. So, yeah, if you are into the very original stuff, the early 90s Deadpool appearances, this will collect them. That's all I have to say about that. Amazing Spider-Man Worldwide hardcover. This is the Spider-Man that has come after... What am I trying to say? After Superior Spider-Man, Amazing Spider-Man 2015 relaunch 1 through 11. So the first oversized hardcover from that line. Deadpool World's Greatest, hardcover volume 1. Again, from the Deadpool relaunch in 2015, numbers 1 through 7, if you're into Deadpool. That's just a standard size book. The X-Men Apocalypse Wars hardcover. I don't know anything about this, really. This is, I think, either going on currently or maybe just finished, but it's the crossover event that crossed over in the X-Books from Marvel while the Avengers were doing the standoff stuff. So, the Apocalypse Wars oversized hardcover, $50, will collect all of the all-new X-Men, Extraordinary X-Men, and Uncanny X-Men. So, basically, just, you know, a X crossover. So if you're into Apocalypse and the X crossover stuff, this will be good for you. I don't really know much about it, but I will probably still pick it up. George Romero's Empire of the Dead. I know absolutely nothing about this, but it looks like it's a zombie vampire thing down here. I think it's probably in the same world of Dawn of the Dead and Day of the Dead and all that stuff. So if you're interested in George Romero, then maybe that's kind of cool. Invincible Iron Man Masterworks. I don't collect Masterworks, but if you do, there's more coming out. And I think that's probably about it. The rest of these are all kind of trade paperbacks and collections. For me, a pretty mediocre month from Marvel, which is fine. I mean, I think they're more focused on, like I said, Civil War II and getting their stuff in line for their fall launch again. So I didn't really expect anything amazing from them. But just kind of average. Lots of focus on crossovers. Not so much focus, like I said, DC is doing such a cool job of curating older stuff and newer stuff. It seems like Marvel is just cashing in on Deadpool at the moment with most of their collections. And, I mean, you know, whatever. All right, back to the main book to finish up our flip-jizz. Ew, flip-jizz. All right, now we are in the comics and graphic novel section itself, so let's see what's going on outside of the big couple studios, see if we can find any good gems in the remainder of the book. Here's one I wanted to stop at. I don't know if I've ever stopped at Boom before, maybe just to look at, like, Adventure Time stuff, but I am interested in this. This is the Klaus hardcover from Grant Morrison and Dan Mora. You know, obviously I'm a sucker for all things Grant Morrison. This is kind of like a retelling of like, the Santa Claus origin story, but with a much more, I don't know, realistic or, like, sort of fairy tale, like, in a traditional sense of kind of, like, scary or maybe not scary, but, like, definitely more kind of parable and, like, bad things happen and good things happen. It's not just, like, a children's tale, kind of like the Santa Claus stuff that we know. It is the all 7 issues in an oversized hardcover. For, what, $35, and it will be coming out in November. So I'm excited for this. I don't know. I read a couple positive reviews around the time of this series first being released, like around issue number 1. And I don't remember reading a bunch about it after that, but Grant Morrison writing about Santa Claus, like, I can do that. And I like, you know, the cover art and the little art samples down there. They're not my absolute favorite style, but I can get behind them. So just kind of a funny little thing from Boom. Thought I would point it out. This looks kind of cool. I don't know that much about it, but it's a Dynamite book called The Art of Atari. It's just neat because, like, I think that time period of video game art is so funny in the sense that the games themselves looked pretty much like shit. And the art had to sell so much of the idea of what you were actually doing because there's a lot of imagination required to make two pixels, you know, running into each other be anything like that looks even remotely like this. And so I think it was so cool to see the way they put out these these illustrations and, like, these really fantastic kind of, like, book style illustrations, and they're really beautiful in a lot of ways, and they're so funny to see, like, how they rip off other science fiction and how they kind of show you all these amazing things you're going to be doing that ultimately are just pixels bumping into each other, you know? It's very funny. So there's going to be, it looks like, a deluxe edition, $100 slipcase version, and then a $39.99 standard version. So if you're into video game history at all, this looks like it'll be a very cool collection just to see. I mean, it really is just beautiful, a lot of these paintings, and then it's always been so funny to me, the juxtaposition of the paintings with what the games actually look like. Here's another artist edition, a Best of Vampirella magazine art edition. Vampirella was one that was running, I think, unless I'm mistaken, Vampirella was running alongside Eerie and Creepy. Those three were like three anthology magazines, and this obviously now is owned by Dynamite, whereas I think Eerie and Creepy distribution is owned by Dark Horse. I don't actually know if that's true, but I believe that Vampirella was running along with Eerie and Creepy. And so this is like a 70s era kind of, you know, anthology, black and white anthology horror magazine. So it looks pretty cool, and looks like if you're into that, it's going to be, you know, super oversized, 14.5 by 21, gigantic. And it's the scans of the original artboard. So if you're, it looks like it has stuff from, do I recognize any of these people? I don't really know any of those names, at least that I'm looking at right now. But it looks like it's going to have the all these different stories from Vampirella 9 through 82 in their completion. And, you know, these are all short stories, so sort of like short horror tales. So cool. If you are into that time period of like 70s horror mags, which there was a lot of great stuff going on then that'll be a cool one to pick up. Fantagraphics, always worth a stop, in my opinion. One that I'm interested in that I don't know much about, it's very small down here, but this is the Otherworld Barbara. It is Moto Hagio. I really don't know much about it, but it was recommended to me from online, and this is the first of two volumes, I believe, hardcover, black and white, about this story. Like I said, I would love to do some more research and figure out what exactly it's about, just because I don't know, but I also don't really want to, you know, like, I would like to go in blind if I can. So, Otherworld Barbara sounds very cool, something to do with lots of weird stuff if you read this, this little thing down here, and this person also did The Heart of Thomas, which it looks like is also available through Fantagraphics, so pretty cool. And then we're getting some reprints down here. This I'm very interested in. I am looking forward to and have just been sort of introduced to Carl Barks and his work on Donald Duck and Uncle Scrooge. So I'm... This basically is a reprint, I think, of the first Carl Barks Library one. So I don't know much about, basically, like, I think there's 11 of these out so far in the Carl Barks Complete Disney Library, and Fantagraphics has been putting them out, like, not necessarily in the order which they're published, just in various orders. So nice to see this stuff just staying in print. I am going to pick this up when I can. Just like I said, I've been expanding my collecting horizons and reading horizons into comic book strips and more, like, this kind of Disney, like, classic art stuff. So very excited to get in on that. Here's an interesting thing. I mean, I know I stop at Humanoids every month and sort of bitch about them, and here's, this is kind of funny to me. They're doing a basically like a $4.99 soft cover Humanoids Presents the Hodoverse book. So it looks like more and more, as I was saying before, they are just working their way into a corner of just being a Hodorowski thing. I mean, here's another, this is a new thing, Carthago, insatiable quest for natural resources. The humans are searching further and deeper into Earth, threatening to unleash monsters thought to be long gone. So it looks like there's going to be, I mean, and the art pages from that do look pretty cool. So there's going to be a horror-themed Carthago shark hardcover book coming out from Humanoids, But I just wanted to point out the Hodoverse stuff because I think it points very directly to what I've been saying about them really stagnating and just repackaging the same stuff over and over and over again. Right, some stuff from Titan that looks pretty cool. The Elric Volume 4, if you can see that down there, Michael Moorcock Library, Elric Volume 4. I have the first two. The third one is about to come out very soon, and then the fourth one is now solicited for November, continuing on the really awesome, trippy art with P. Craig Russell adapted by Roy Thomas. I think it's super cool. I don't know that much about the character. I know he's like an extremely popular sword and sorcery character. I have not started reading them. I want to get a couple more of the books under my belt before I start reading them. But Volume 4 is coming out, and I have liked what I've seen of Volume 1 and 2 so far. This looks very cool to me. The complete James Bond classic comic strip collection. This one is called Dr. No, and it collects six classic James Bond tales collected in a deluxe oversized omnibus format. So I'm very excited about it. I don't know much about the James Bond comics, but I do know that I like I said, right now I'm getting into detective and spy comic strip stuff a lot. So I am excited about this. 60s comic strips, $40 for, so I guess, a couple different stories. And then I don't know if the complete James Bond Spectre, the complete comic collection, I'm not sure what that means. I don't know if there was stuff before 1958 to 1960, so I don't know. But looks very neat. And as we get to Xenoscope Entertainment, I think we are just about finished. Yep, now we're in the books. So, yeah, I mean, yeah, mixed bag of stuff. There was some very cool stuff in there. I think some of it I'm more excited than others. Obviously, my recent interest in comic strips and stuff has kind of expanded the things that I'm interested in. I think that's partially due to the fact that, you know, I like reading everything and stuff like this month for Marvel, for example, where all you get from them is Deadpool collections and collections of their most recent stuff, or omnibus of things that have already been collected in other hardcover forms. Like, that's fine. It's just it leaves me a little empty. Like, I just want something more than that, and so I'm expanding my horizons a little bit. You know, I've always been into European and older comics, and I just really have fallen in love with black and white comic strip and art of that time period, you know, 30s through the 60s, sort of. So, yeah, that's about all for me for right now from the previews. I hope you liked this flip through, and it was hopefully helpful in your decisions about what to purchase in the upcoming months. And yeah, I'm gonna be keep on trucking. Yeah, I'm going to keep on trucking with a number of videos in the next little while. The Akira one I'm still working on. Probably gonna shoot that in the next couple days. And yeah, just keeping you guys abreast of all of the stuff that I am doing. So hopefully you would leave me comments about what you found interesting in this previous book. Thumbs up or thumbs down, depending on if you liked or would like to see me change stuff about these videos. And I will see you guys in the next video. In the meantime, you can get in touch with me at any of the social media links in the description. And yeah, I'm always around answering comments and stuff, so please feel free to drop me a line and I would love to get in touch. Thanks so much for watching as always, and I will see you guys next time. Have a good one.